In this video, we're talking about the motional EMF induced across a conductive body moving perpendicular to a magnetic field. And one way to look at this is in terms of the forces exerted on charges. So in this rod, I could say there's electrons free to move, and I want to think about the forces on these electrons. And I use the Lorentz force right-hand rule for this. I put my fingers in the direction of V, and I sweep out to the direction of B. My thumb points in the direction of a force on a positive charge, and I have to reverse that to get the force on a negative charge. Well, that means the force on these electrons is downward. And as this rod cruises along in this magnetic field, you're going to end up with electrons accumulating at the bottom end of it, and that creates a negative potential there, and you're going to end up with a deficit of electrons at the positive end of it. Alternatively, if you complete the circuit, a current is going to end up flowing. Electrons moving clockwise, the current will be counterclockwise. So this force analysis tells us which way we would read the voltage with a voltmeter hooked up to this circuit. So this metal rod again is sliding along with the speed of V on these conductive wires, and my voltmeter is hooked up here to read the potential difference that's being induced. And that force argument has given me the answer of which way that goes. And that's actually the follow-up question at the end of our question. So positive on this side, negative on this side. Now what we actually want to focus on in this video is making an electromagnetic induction argument instead of a force on charges argument. The argument that I just made about the force on charges actually leads to exactly the same answer for the induced potential difference. And in fact, it's the exact same physics as the Hall effect and the Hall voltage. So I'll post a link to that video real quick. Now we're taking an alternative approach to it using electromagnetic induction, and we're hoping the answer comes out to be the same. So instead of viewing it as forces on charges, I look at this conductive loop that is growing, and I say as this loop grows, as that metal bar slides along, it's going to capture more and more inward pointing magnetic field. To oppose that change in flux, my induced magnetic field must point the opposite direction. So increasing inward magnetic flux needs to be opposed by induced outward magnetic flux. And I ask, which way does the current have to flow to get that done? And I use the Ampere's law right-hand rule for this. I line up my thumb in the direction of current, curl the fingers of my right hand around to create the desired flux, and I get that leftward in the top branch, in other words, counterclockwise, would be the correct way for this current to flow. And if the circuit is broken by a voltmeter, I'll have an accumulation of positive charge on this end and negative charge on the other end, and I get the same result for the sine of the voltage. Now let's get a handle on the problem quantitatively by using this electromagnetic induction approach. So to do this, I'm going to start by saying that this coil currently has a length of x. And what I'm trying to do here is express the flux through it so that I can use Faraday's law. So my initial flux is going to be AB cosine theta. Well, this loop is already perpendicular to the magnetic field, so the normal vector is parallel to it. Cosine theta, I don't care about. I know my flux is maximized, and it's going to be equal to AB. And the area of my loop is given by X times L, and the strength of my magnetic field is B. Then I allow a short amount of time, delta T, to go by, and during that time, the loop is going to move by an extra distance of delta X, just a small increase. My loop is a little wider than it was before, and my flux should be a little bigger than it was before. Again, it's just AB, but it's my slightly larger A final. And the width is now X plus delta X. My length stays the same, and there's the strength of my magnetic field. Now I invoke Faraday's law, and I'm really just concerned with the magnitude of the induced voltage. I already figured out the direction, so I don't need the minus sign from Faraday's law. I only have one loop, so N is one. And my delta phi, the change in phi here, is X plus delta X times LB minus my original flux, which was XLB. And that's all divided by delta T. When I look at the algebra in the numerator, I look at distributing the LB to both terms in this binomial. The first term would be an LB times X, but I see a negative one of those over here in the numerator, so those are going to cancel, and I get delta X times LB over delta T. And this is a very common trick in these derivations. delta x over delta t appears in this expression. That's the speed. So I end up with VLB. Now this is exactly the same result we got for the Hall voltage induced when the drift velocity was the speed that we used. L was the width of the conductor that we were using, and B, of course, was the strength of the magnetic field. So it's just two different pathways in physical reasoning, giving us the exact same answer. Let's wrap things up by applying our new formula to a simple example. So again, the induced voltage, if I have a conductive body moving at right angles to a magnetic field, is just going to be VLB. In this case, we're talking about an airplane flying through a magnetic field perpendicular to it, and that's the Earth's magnetic field. We have a wingspan of 28 meters. It's traveling 180 meters per second. The wings are at right angles to the Earth's magnetic field, so we don't have to worry about a cosine theta component, and the strength of the field is 0.4 Gauss. The Gauss needs to be converted to Tesla. That's a factor of 10 to the negative 4. Other than that, it's just a plug and chug problem. I have a speed of 180. I have a length of 28 meters. I have a magnetic field strength of 0.4 times 10 to the negative 4 Tesla. And I end up with a 0.202 volt induced potential difference between the tips of the wings. If you find the physics content on Zach's Lab helpful, click on the Zach's Lab logo on the right to browse playlists and subscribe to the channel. I produce over 100 new videos per month, and subscribing is the easiest way to find new content. Thanks for watching.